Yeah, okay. So thank you very much, Ralph, for the kind introduction. And as you said, it's a real pleasure to be back here. I see some friends from my days here 10 years ago at RSIS. So it's a real pleasure to be back, and I want to thank Ralph and Joseph, who is not here, for the opportunity to make a presentation today. This presentation is from an ongoing work for a book on explaining international politics in Asia since 1945. And the primary argument of that book is that the contested processes of nation and state making in Asia have been the primary drivers of international politics in Asia, not so much the system level variables of the distribution of power, norms, and values. These system level variables are in fact defined by the nature of the political units in the system. And it's unfortunate that IR compartmentalizes and really focuses on system level and not focusing on what's happening within countries. But that's part and parcel of the disciplinary compartmentalization. What I've tried to do in the book is basically to look at four outcomes: war, peace, cooperation, and order. And try to explain these four outcomes in Asia since 1945 by focusing on nation and state making. But, you know, in the presentation today, since I have half an hour, I will not focus on cooperation and order. I'll focus very much on the outbreaks of war and peace in Asia since 1945. I'll also discuss some of the shortcomings of the existing theories of IR, how they're able to or unable to explain war and peace in Asia. But let me first begin by setting out the war and peace situation in Asia since 1945. Okay. So if you look at this chart, you will see that from 1945, I chose 1945 simply because most Asian countries became independent after World War II. The only three countries that were not colonized, Japan, Nepal, and Thailand. But even Nepal and Thailand were semi-colonies in some ways because there's very strong influence of colonial powers in these countries. But 1945 really is the starting point at which most countries in Asia became independent. China was not colonized, but parts of China were under colonial rule, and including under Japanese rule. So if you look at this chart here, you'll see that there were many wars in Asia. 1965 to 1975 is where you see the Second Indochina War, the Second Laotian War, North Vietnam versus Cambodia, India, Pakistan. So there were like four or five wars at one particular time. But as you move further down, you see that there have only been two wars since 1979. 79 was when the Chinese punitive attack on Vietnam. After that, there were only two wars. One is the Sino-Vietnamese border clash in 1987 and the India-Pakistan Kargil War in 1991. But those two wars were very short-lived. Major purpose was achieved by those wars. They were limited in scope, duration, location, and so forth. So essentially, after 1979, we see a long period of peace from 79 till about now. Except those two short wars that I mentioned, there have been no real major outbreaks. A war in the literature is defined as having at least 1,000 battle deaths. A minor war is between 25 casualties and about 1,000. Military incidents are defined in the literature as below 25 battle casualties. So there have been numerous military incidents, but really no major war since 1979, except for the Kargil War, as well as the Sino-Vietnamese border clash in 1987. How do I get to the next slide? Okay. If you look at the number of war diets in Asia, you also notice that there were 9 war diets in Asia. China-Tibet with a war in 1950-51, China-Taiwan, China-India, China-Vietnam, India-Pakistan, North Vietnam, South Vietnam, / US, Vietnam-Laos, Vietnam-Cambodia, North Korea-South Korea. Most of these diets have either ended or stalemated. Stalemates in China, Taiwan, India, Pakistan, North Korea, South Korea, and the others have ended. And the same goes if you look at minor wars between 25 and 1,000. Again, the frequency increases in the 60s and 70s, 80s, and then declines quite substantially after reaching a peak in the 80s. So the question arises, what explains the outbreak of wars and what explains the transition to peace? And my argument basically is that it is the contested processes of making nations and states and weak states that were the cause of wars in Asia as well as external intervention in these conflicts. And as countries became more legitimate, both domestically and internationally, as the economies grew and developed and the state capacity increased and as national resilience increased, there was a transition to peace. And at the same time, increasing state capacity made it possible for countries to develop effective deterrence. So and deterrence has become the mainstay of peace in Asia. Deterrence has prevented war on the Korean Peninsula, across the Taiwan Strait, between India and Pakistan, and it's also a key factor in the relationship between China and the United States. Many people talk about the growing power of China and how this might give rise to either conflict or to war. I would argue that deterrence, strategic deterrence, works well in the Sino-American relationship, and deterrence has become the mainstay of peace. So I will begin by noticing the inadequacy of system-level theories, both realist and liberal, as well as existing unit-level theories in explaining war and peace in Asia since 1945. If you take new realism, the basic focus is on the deep structure, which is anarchy. Anarchy is used to explain security dilemmas. But as new realists themselves admit, it can explain the recurrence of wars, but not the outbreak of specific wars. So anarchy really cannot explain why at times countries go to war and why at times they are at peace when countries become more secure. So it has great difficulty in explaining that, and I'll be happy if anyone can counter that statement. Classical realism basically focuses on the distribution of power, and it's unclear when peace breaks out in classical realism. If it is during periods of hegemony, only certain types of hegemony have been peaceful. Now, those types of hegemonies cannot be explained without invoking ideas and the nature of the political system itself. And some have argued that a bipolar system or a multipolar system is more peaceful. It's unclear which distribution of power is more conducive to peace. But the fact remains that Asia from 1945 to 1991 was militarily bipolar. But it is during that period that Asia experienced high intensity and high frequency of war. It also experienced the transition to peace. It also experienced the development of cooperation. So all of this happened under a structure of military bipolarity. So it's very difficult to say that distribution of power explains the outbreak of war and the transition to peace. Commercial liberalism, which was very popular in Asia in the 70s and 80s, and it's also popular in some Western countries, basically the focus on trading states, the focus on growing interdependence, but the idea was that as countries become more interdependent, they may not go to war with each other. And people very often cite World War I as to counter the point that although the countries were very highly interdependent at that time, it did not prevent them from going to war to each other. I mean, that's a very frequent example that's cited. But to me, I think if you look at the relationship between economics and security is a complex one. Taiwan and China are very closely interlinked economically, and yet Taiwan perceives China as an existential threat. Japan and China are very closely linked economically. China and the United States are linked very closely economically. And yet they perceive each other as a threat from various angles. So the relationship between economics and security is a complex one. It's possible to argue, like in the Taiwan case, that it mitigates and perhaps temporarily buys time. But ultimately, a political solution is required. Economic interdependence alone cannot resolve political problems. And I think that's pretty much understood. Sociological liberalism, some have argued that, like in ASEAN, close cooperation, as well as methods of decision making can lead to peace. But I think ASEAN has been oversold. There is a tendency in many cities of Southeast Asia to emphasize ASEAN. But peace in Southeast Asia precedes and predates ASEAN. The Indonesian confrontation had to end before the formation of ASEAN. Vietnam had to withdraw from Laos and Cambodia before these countries joined ASEAN. So ASEAN has not been, the driver of peace in Southeast Asia. Even after these countries became members, if you look at this very carefully and be analytical, was there disputes between these countries? Was the dispute serious enough? Did these countries have military capabilities to go to war with each other? And was there certainty that if they did go to war, that they will win? You know, so there are many, many questions that have to be answered. But in this region, it's an act of faith to believe in ASEAN. But I think one has to be more analytical and somewhat more critical. And in my view, I think sociological liberalism has also its limits in terms of explaining the development of peace. Then there are arguments like democratic peace. Democracies don't go to war with each other. If you look at Asia, most of the countries were not democracies, and yet Asia has experienced peace since about 1979. How does one explain that? China and Taiwan were authoritarian, Leninist authoritarian states until the early 80s, when Taiwan transited to democracy. And yet they did not go to war with each other still since 1958. Likewise, between North Korea and South Korea. South Korea did not become a democracy until the 80s. And yet, there was no outbreak of war between North and South Korea since 1953. So I think most of these theories, whether illiberal democracies, authoritarian states are more inclined towards war, or democracies don't go to war with each other, they cannot explain the outbreak of war and peace in Asia. As a consequence, as I looked at this, and I was thinking, what really explains the outbreak of war and peace in Southeast in Asia as a whole since 1945? And I sort of focused more on the unit level, but more on the process of making nations and states. By nation, I mean a social political community. By state, I mean institutions of governance, including the type of political system. So most of these countries were new and they were trying to make nations and states, and they also bought into the idea that nations and states must coincide. So this belief in the attempt to make nations and states were the cause of many of the wars, and the legitimation of these countries over time was also a reason for the transition to peace. I'm not arguing that system-level factors are unimportant. In other words, the distribution of power, the norms and values and so on, they're not unimportant. But my point is, they are informed by developments at the unit level. And also, they are not the primary drivers of war and peace. They mitigate, they amplify, they set the international context, sometimes they prolong the conflict, they escalate the conflict, but they were not the cause of the outbreak of war or the transition to peace. The Cold War has ended, but many of the conflicts that were ongoing in the Cold War have not ended in Asia. So, and the causes for them are all local and bilateral. Let me try and explain this with some examples so that, you know, it becomes clear. Take the China-Taiwan conflict. Its origins goes back to the 1927 struggle between the KMT and the CCP. It was an attempt as to, it was, who was the rightful ruler of China? It was the contest over that question. And that contest ended in 1949 with the victory of the CCP. And the KMT fled to Taiwan. So then the international context became important. With the US support for the KMT, that war became an international war between China and Taiwan. But the primary, the beginning of that war had to do more with the contestations over who was the rightful ruler of China. Right? And today the contest is over the identity and sovereignty of Taiwan. So, and the question is, can there be one Chinese nation and two Chinese states, or must there be one Chinese nation and one Chinese state? So that is the crux of the issue in terms of the China-Taiwan conflict. Likewise, between North Vietnam and South Vietnam, the aim of the Communist Party of Vietnam was to liberate South Vietnam, unify Vietnam, and unify it under communist rule. It was all about nation-making and state-making. Likewise, the United States became involved in the context of the Cold War, but the United States was not the instigator. This conflict had its origins in the first Indochina conflict to overthrow the colonial rule, and then the attempt by the Vietnamese to unify Vietnam. So I think, and I can go and explain North Korea and South Korea likewise, can there be one Korean nation and two Korean states, or must there be one Korean nation and one Korean state? The fight between the North and the South, although it had some origins in the Cold War grounding, it's really today about what is to be the identity of the Korean nation and the Korean state. That is the fundamental issue. It is not the nuclear issue. It is not the contest between China and the United States. The real crux of the problem on the Korean Peninsula is, can there be two separate Korean states? Or must there be only one Korean state? And who is to define that Korean state, whether it's North Korea or South Korea? Likewise, between India and Pakistan, these two countries came out of partition of British India. One was an Islamic state, and the other was a liberal democratic civic nation state. And so the question was over Kashmir, whether it should belong to Islamic Pakistan or to a secular civil civic nation India. So you can, most of these conflicts, you can actually bring them down to identity and sovereignty over the question of nation and state making. Likewise, Indonesian competition against Malaysia. What is it all about? It was not the distribution of power. It was about the idea of Malaysia, whether Sukarno was accepting of that idea. The confrontasi was essentially a non-acceptance of the idea of Malaysia. Ganchang Malaysia was essentially the effort by Sukarno to crush Malaysia. So, and the tensions between Malaysia and Singapore had a lot to do with nation-state making. So I think if you go through most of the conflicts, and I'm rushing through them quickly, you can explain them through these lenses of contest. And these are not just international contestations. Some of them were domestic contestations. You know, some groups tried to, in power, tried to create a nation of their own, in their own imagination. There were other groups that contested that notion as well. And if you forget, if you think back, there were contestations of the state, like the incumbent governments in Malaysia, Philippines, Thailand. They were all challenged by communist parties in these countries. Those were contestations over the state itself, the type of political system. And I think this is not a linear projection. We'll go through this again. In fact, right now we're going through contestations over nation and state making. It's been, there's a tendency in the literature to term the contestation over nation making as conflicts between center and periphery. What's happening in Myanmar today is contestations over the type of the Myanmarese nation. What's happening in Northeast India is over the national identity of India. likewise in southern Thailand, in southern Philippines, the Uyghurs, the Tibetans. All of this is over the question of national identity, nation-making, and likewise in the construction of states, where there are going to be one-party dominant systems or multi-party democratic systems. All of this is contestations over the idea of state-making. I must admit there are a few conflicts I'm still struggling with to explain using this lens. One is the Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia and Laos. It doesn't quite neatly fit into this paradigm that I'm advancing. Likewise, the Sino-Vietnamese War and some of the territorial disputes that are ongoing, especially at sea, they don't fit neatly into this framework that I'm articulating, and I have to think a bit more about them to see how best they can be fitted or how else they disprove the argument that I'm trying to make. But, you know, as it stands, I believe that the contested processes of nation and state making, international and domestic contestations of nations, explain many of the wars that have been in Asia since 1945, as well as those conflicts ongoing on the Korean Peninsula, across the Taiwan Straits, and between India and Pakistan. Those are the three most acute conflicts. But as I mentioned, since 1979, there have only been two wars. And since the Kargil War, there has not been an outbreak of war in Asia. What explains this? And my argument is that growing domestic and international legitimacy of nations and states, focus on economic development in much of Asia, and increasing state capacity explain the declining utility of war as an instrument of state policy. When you know, it's very common for those of you who read Clausewitz to think of war as an instrument of state policy. It is an instrument, a force as an instrument of state policy, not necessarily war. Most, if you think of the role of force today, it's very much more in the role of deterrence. It's not in an offensive role. Most of these conflicts cannot be won by war, so they're in a stalemate situation. Deterrence has come to dominate. But there's also a growing international legitimacy of Asian countries. If you look at the Asian political map, how many countries have disappeared from the political map since 1945? South Vietnam has disappeared. What other countries have disappeared from the political map of Asia? There have been some new countries. Singapore came to the scene in 1965. Malaysia came to the scene in 1963. Timor came into being more recently. So there have been a few new countries. And if you look at the map and say which countries may disappear or which may be added on, maybe Taiwan could disappear. Maybe one of the two Koreas could disappear from the political map. But they could also become legitimate political entities on the map. Nobody knows. But the key point is that compared to early periods, the Asian political map has become much more stable. There's growing international legitimacy. It's very difficult for countries to invade and conquer and occupy countries as they could do in a colonial period. And rising nationalism makes it more difficult. There is a tendency in the literature to look at rising nationalism as dangerous. I would argue that rising nationalism, I'm not even sure what nationalism means, but anyway, I mean, that's what people use. And nationalism could be defensive too. You know, it makes it more difficult for other powers to invade and occupy you. It increases the cost of invasion and occupation. And the focus on economic growth is a double-edged sword. Countries want to participate in global economies, regional economies, to grow, and so they want a stable international environment. But that economic growth can also spur military modernization and spur development of new and sophisticated capabilities and create an unsettling environment. So it's both a plus and a minus in that sense. But that's what's happening. Most countries in Asia are focused on economic growth and development. And this economic development increases state capacity. So the more revenue comes into state coffers, the state is able to penetrate and reach out to more parts of the country and consolidate and make the country more resilient. You know, I mean, at one point, national resilience was a key term in Southeast Asia. It's no longer used. But if you put it in this context, national resilience is increased by this economic growth and development. And increased capacity also makes it more possible to develop effective deterrence. And countries have now acquired either nuclear weapon capability, ballistic missile capability, cyber capabilities, and conventional military capability. And so deterrence has become the mainstay. The main role of the armed forces today is deterrence. It is not invasion and occupation. So there has been a changing role of force as a consequence of these developments. And deterrence has become the mainstay of peace in the China-Taiwan dyad, North-South Korea, India-Pakistan, the Sino-US relationship, Sino-Indian relationship, and Sino-Japanese relationship. I look at Japan's, people call it moving to the right and rising nationalism and so forth, but I think it's only natural that Japan will move to build effective deterrence against China, just as China builds effective deterrence against Japan. And in the case of Japan, extended deterrence of the U.S. nuclear umbrella becomes very crucial. And that, in my view, will become much more important for Japan as time moves on. So the transition to peace can be explained by the growing political legitimacy of the Asian map, the focus on economic growth and development, and increasing state capacity, national resilience, and the development of effective deterrence over time. So, but this peace is peace defined as the absence of major war. It is not peace in terms of no conflict at all. And I think this peace will endure. Peace defined as the absence of major war is likely to prevail. Change in the distribution of power, especially with the rise of China, growing military capabilities, continuing disputes, and emergence of new security challenges will likely create an unsettling environment. And many people mistake this unsettling environment, and there's now a growing chorus of war. In Washington, D.C., you go to conferences and people talk about the growing tension between the U.S. and China and how this could lead to conflict and war. And I thought this was only in the U.S., but it's also in Europe, it's also in Asia. There are a lot of people who follow this line of thinking and talk about. But I would argue that the factors that have sustained peace since 1979 are still at work in Asia. And I think to focus on the rise of China and the changing distribution of power is to focus on the wrong thing. But that's where much of the emphasis is and much of the money is. So people focus on the rise of China and the possibility of conflict. But you look at all these wars, they were not caused by the weakness of China or by the rise of China. They were caused by the contested processes of making nations and states. And making nations and states takes hundreds of years. Look at UK. After 300 years, Scotland still went to a referendum to decide whether it remained part of the United Kingdom or not. There's still groups in Spain that are fighting for independence. There's still groups in Canada, the Quebecois movement, which there's a constitutional process whereby they can become a separate country. So state-making and nation-making is a never-ending process. It can be strong at some points and weak at some points. And today we talk about non-state actors. Who are these people? They're all from countries where states are weak. It's a Libya or the IS movement, Al-Qaeda. Where are they housed? They're all housed in weak states and weak nations. And what are they fighting over? And so I think if you look at this in this context, it becomes a lot clearer, it seems to me. Now let me move on to the last part of my talk, which is strengthening peace in Asia. This peace which rests on deterrence is inherently not very stable. It's risk-prone, it's subject to miscalculations, and it can precipitate crisis situations. So whilst deterrence is now the mainstay of peace in several dyads, we need to go beyond that. We need to resolve disputes. We cannot simply shelve them. The shelving disputes is a favorite of many political leaders. You talk to them and say, let's shelve this dispute. That's actually passing the buck. It's passing the buck to the next generation. If we can't solve it, what is the guarantee that the next generation will be wiser? Why should they be wiser? Why should the problem be easier to resolve in the next generation? Why can't we resolve it now? And political leaders are very much stuck to this view that the political map is frozen. It is not frozen. The political map is ever changing. In Malaysia, whenever I give this talk, I tell people, look at the map of Malaysia. It was Kelantan, Perak, and all before. Then they came as, with the British colonization, the federated military states, the non-federated states, Malay states, and the Strait settlements. All right, and then came Malaya. And then came Malaysia with the inclusion of Sabah, Sarawak, and Singapore. And then came 1965 with the separation of Singapore. So the political map has never been constant. It will change, and it will keep on changing. And yet politicians will say, we will not surrender even an inch of our territory. That's the famous line. All right? So I think if you understand, and do you want to spend, you know, look at Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore. They resolve the island disputes between them by going to the International Court of Justice. Of course, there's a bad aftertaste in several countries. But the point is, if you didn't resolve them, you're spending a whole lot of money, creating a lot of international tension, and so forth, as is happening in the South China Sea. So we must make an effort to resolve these disputes. There will, of course, be winners, and there will, of course, be losers. But these are minor in compared to what you will achieve through the resolution. So it's up to us to convince political leaders and so forth that, you know, give them the analysis and let them think about this in terms of, you know, if you go to Kashmir and I look at 500,000 Indian soldiers, it's like an occupied country. You cannot compel people to stay with you. And I tell Chinese, you cannot compel the Tibetans and Uyghurs to stay with you. You know, by the constitution, China is a civic nation state. There's no ethnic majority. But in practice, it's a Han majority state. So the making of nations is very, very important. And the changes to the Asian political map will not come about through international war. Will come out through internal contestation. Who knows, Burma may break up. Malaysia may break up. Political systems may change. All right? So I think if you really focus on this nation and state making, it gives you a much better entree into understanding war, peace, and also I didn't discuss cooperation and order, but it also non-interference in domestic affairs as a norm. Where does that come from? It comes from domestic developments on nation and state making, not from anywhere else. I'm just, you know, just digressing to make a point here. So I think it's important, and if you want to strengthen peace in Asia, then we must focus on resolving conflicts and having new political imaginations. China, Taiwan, that conflict cannot be resolved without a new political imagination. We must accept that there may be even new nations and new states. You know, if the Quebecois can become independent through a constitutional provision, what's wrong in Aceh becoming a separate country through a constitutional process? Or Indonesia had to reimagine itself. You know, federalism was a dirty word in Indonesia. They had to make an amendment to the constitution to allow autonomy for Aceh. All right? So I think you need new political imaginations. You've got to decentralize power. You've got to accept multiple identities. So these are issues that we need to deal with. And I think these only become possible if we take this approach of nation and state making to war and peace in Asia. And you know, although I've limited it to Asia, you can actually apply it equally well to Africa or to any other parts of the world. But this is a way of, and I think this the approach I've taken bridges comparative politics and international politics. It makes it essential for international relations scholars to understand what's happening in the domestic politics, as well as sociology, and it brings in a lot of sociology as well. So I think with that, I will conclude and open it up for discussion. You know, I'm in the very early stages of writing this book, so if you all have any comments and you want to challenge the argument I've made, I'd welcome that very much.